is awesome to be with you, and I hope that this has been a good week for you. I hope that the weekend is outstanding. I hope that none of you get whatever it is that's going around that a few of you, of your colleagues that aren't here have. They have either the heebie-jeebies or the Ebus on the office. Don't catch either of those. Or the creeping crud. Don't get any of those. We're going to do some stuff that's kind of taxonomy today, kind of classification stuff. I'll explain that in just a bit. Let's pray first, though. We come to you, Father, with minds that like to have some sort of organizing schemes so that we can come back and find our place when we visit something that we thought about before, so that we can talk to each other and at least have a sense that we're talking about the same thing. We pray that you will help us to be at the same time good at making those schemes and keeping the categories straight, and all the while transcending them and recognizing how play-like. Bless us with the ability to hold contradictory ideas. In Jesus' name, amen. I would like to talk a little bit today about the branches of philosophy. Okay? Philosophy has philosophy has a lot of parts to it. A lot of things that make it up. And you've noticed that in giving definitions of philosophy, I don't even know if we've given half of the definitions yet that we could give, and might give this term that I'll want you to be familiar with. The point being that these definitions are all attempts to try to characterize something that's very difficult to characterize, probably because it's experienced a little bit by everyone. There are a lot of topics, there are a lot of phenomena. And a phenomenon is something that you can experience. Phenomena are those things that you get a sense of and have as an experience in your consciousness. That's what a phenomenon. Phenomena is the plural. Phenomenology is to try to study carefully your experience as you're experiencing it. It's been developed as a real discipline. There's some major players in contributing to the notion of an enterprise. Buddhist mind disciplines have a head start on Western phenomenology, but we won't belabor that. I just want you to know what I mean when I say phenomena, or when I say phenomenological. It means having to do with your experience. And it's good to know that, because people, even in common journalism, sometimes when they're interviewing neuroscientists or psychologists, or even that study religions, they'll drop a term like that, and we think we kind of know what it means. A phenomenon is kind of a thing. But like a lot of words, we just pass over it, and we never really get what they mean. We just kind of go right along. So I'd like you to be familiar with what in the world phenomenology is, phenomenon. But philosophy involves some phenomena. Some experiences in looking at Socrates, as we have, we've noted that it was a point of, for him, it was sort of a inflection point in his path, in his thought journey, when he considered a certain idea, when it went aha and it clicked, he considered that one of the most important components sense of his enlightenment, of his having become enlightened. Now, when we speak of enlightenment, it's hard to separate any discussion of the term enlightenment from that notion of Plato's cave in the Republic. That idea of actually seeing real light and understanding that the common illumination is sort of, well, illusory rather than truly illuminating. And actually getting that notion and then going up sort of out of the cave and seeing the actual sunlight, that means different things for different people. Mystics in various spiritual traditions and outside of spiritual traditions speak of having had some sort of point where they became seriously enlightened. Something happened and they have a flash. Paul, when he was on the road to Damascus, he had been engaged in not just bullying. The bullying kind of actually turned to lethal abuse of the people that were calling themselves Christians. They had been deemed the dangerous religious ones. Not unlike what's going on today, as people have utilized one religious group as a scapegoat, sort of as a lightning rod, as a focal point, to be the out-group, to draw other people together, and then garner their support for whatever, whether it's an election or it's to be able to spend money on defense stuff because you've got interest in getting it spent because you're going to profit from it spent or whatever. In Paul's time, he was not exactly a ringleader. I think later on he characterized himself as more important in the persecution than what the story actually supports. He was kind of the one who was kind of watching people's coats so they didn't get stolen while they were actually hurting somebody. And that's not really like a ringleader, but he characterized himself as being, well, I got to say, there's somebody who's really gone to the top of the media, getting the most Google hits in the world right now, who reminds me a heck of a lot of Paul. Because for Paul, anything about him was marvelous. It was unbelievably grand. It was great. It was a great thing. He was the Pharisee's Pharisee. Don't think anyone could out-Pharisee me. Paul, if you want to understand Paul, you're getting to watch Paul holding office right now. He's a lot like that person. A lot like that person. Read him and see if anything sounds at all familiar these days. Fantastic. Just fantastic. Just unbelievable. So unbelievable, people won't even know how unbelievable until they find out that it's that unbelievable. But Paul had some kind of an experience where there was this flash and he saw some kind of great light and was also enlightened, and it turned his priorities completely, and he heard a voice. He heard a voice that didn't sound like his or anybody around. And he couldn't even see as a result for a while. And he was like somebody who'd been, you know, hit in the head and given a concussion or had a stroke or something. And he heard that what he was doing was 100% wrong. That who he was persecuting, he was persecuting the good guys. And so he had this complete, by his experience, as he experienced it, he had this complete turnaround. Under the Bodhi tree, the Buddha had a similar claim for an event. Muhammad claimed to have that kind of thing. And a lot of people today claim that they're doing something, they're pursuing some sort of idea, reasoning something, focusing on something, or meditating, or whatever they're doing. They're at a meeting. They're at a church meeting. And then something just happens, and then the tears pour out, and they loss of control is gone. They just almost pass out, and then they have this complete change of priorities and values, and the world looks like the universe looks like a different place. In Adventist circles, it's really encouraged that these enlightenment experiences not be referred to in enlightenment terms, but as a conversion. And usually I think the social pressures to keep those more subtle and more dignified within an Adventist tradition. When you go to a Pentecostal group, you can see people that if they did that in an Adventist church, people that aren't familiar with that kind of thing would be not sure whether to call an ambulance or an exorcist. They don't know what's actually going on. I've been to some big Pentecostal revivals and observed what's going on, and I've had practitioners, the clergy and worship leaders, come and do this to me and give me what I couldn't get. I would have been happy to have the experience, but nothing was happening. I guess I just didn't know how to get in the right spirit or something, because it didn't do anything. They said, and the fire of the Holy Spirit, and I was like, I'm waiting. And
what do you think it is that causes them to go into like trance, or?
You want to know what I think it is at what level in the brain?
Yeah.
The neuroscience.
Mm-hmm.
In neuroscientific terms, the parietal cortex and the frontal lobe. The anterior cingulate cortex and the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. Those three areas experience at a point a lot less activity at first. A little more like a surge, and then almost like shutting them down. If we have a person in a scanner when it happened. When their parietal area is less active, part of what's less active is the function that the parietal area serves as the neurocorrelate for, and that's the place where you get your actual sense of yourself as separate from things that aren't you. Like, you know, if you got your computer there on the desk, if I say that's you, you know that's not you, and you know he's not you, she's not you. But it's nearly always the case when somebody becomes enlightened that they lose the sense of discreteness for what's self and what's non-self. So that part of the brain is kind of becomes less active right away. And they have this sense, first of all, that the categories are artificial, or that they're absurd. So that's the same experience that my father had when he took LSD when he was studying philosophy at Berkeley. And they told him this was what they ought to consider doing. He had that same experience. So you have this sense that you and I are the same person. Well, it was for him, but I think that the drug is sort of hacking the same thing that the environmental cues in a Pentecostal meeting, for instance, drumming in a shamanic culture in a spiritual context, or whirling dervishes in the Sufi tradition, going around in circles chanting the same thing over and over, like passage with three of God's names, and is saying it very rhythmically while they go in circles. Same thing as in transcendental meditation, when you say the Sanskrit mantra, you just say it however enough times, and you have these experiences that are, you know, you just have this bliss consciousness where everything is just one. You're part of everything, so you don't. all of a sudden, all these things that we have to do to hold the universe at bay so it doesn't hurt us. Other people are just trying to screw us, take our stuff, do whatever. The universe is going to make us freeze to death or get hit by a truck or, you know, the dam is going to break and the water's going to go through town or somebody's trying to sell us something that we don't have money for or they're going to come and take, you know, or we're not going to get it, we're going to get kicked out of our house. It's just never ending. Somebody's a bigot and they're going to hurt us. You know, somebody's got to worry about violence and getting ripped off. Come out and where the heck is my car? Oh, geez, someone else got my car. You know, all these things we're constantly having to worry about. If you got a pension plan, you can't count on the pension plan. They're going to excuse the people that promised it to you that you paid into. They're not going to make them pay it back. They're going to pay it off to some billionaire buddy. And it's so all this whole business that constantly forces us to be amped on cortisol, which is a cortisol is something when our sympathetic nervous system is activated, sort of our fight or flight thing. You know, the four F's of the autonomic nervous system. Fight, flight, feed, and breed. And the first two are sympathetic, and the second two are parasympathetic. They're your kind of come to home state and relax. So when this happens, when you have this notion that everybody is just us, it's just everybody's me. You're me, God is me. The speeding truck is me, even if I was hit. And it's just, I'm me, I'm the whole universe. So when you have that, it's like this ultimate parasympathetic, like it's a parasympathetic grand slam home run end of series. You know, it takes the World Series of parasympathetic, and then it stays that way. Yeah, then you have this sense of, there's nothing that is against me, because it is me. If there's something that looks like it's against me, it's me against myself, which is absurd, so I don't have to worry about it. It's like, do I have to be afraid of this thing doing this? Unless I have, like, alien hand syndrome, I don't have to worry about this. I can just stop doing that nonsense whenever I want. So you have the sense of the world being lifted off of your shoulders. So you can then have forever, you can have, like, almost no cortisol. You're just not able to get riled up. Maybe even when you should. Is that smoke I smell? Very peaceful. You could actually get to the point where you probably are so enlightened, you'd probably be a really lousy cop. You know, you're not able to do your, you need to have a little sympathetic. So it kind of locks you in to this perpetual low cortisol, high, high oxytocin, super functioning mirror neurons. It allows your telomeres to actually lengthen instead of shorten. They're supposed to be like the time bomb to your mortality. They can actually, once you're enlightened, they get lengthened. So you live longer, your heart disease is less, and all of this. I could take either position. I think that being that way is probably the way we were created to be. And it would be good to hang out in places where it's safe to be that way. But I'm not sure every place is the safest place to be that way. I mean, think about the martyrs who actually, they lit a fire under them and burned them up. Like all the lists in Fox's Book of Martyrs. And they sang hymns that were in observable bliss. They weren't even feeling the pain. Sure. You know, I don't know. think Jesus was in a perpetual state of that. I mean, if you look at him, he appears like those people that are enlightened from whatever tradition. And we have people within Adventism who are obviously like these, who find enlightenment in Adventism. It's not foreign to us to have people that are totally spiritually enlightened. They're just the way we're really going to be in heaven, the way we were created. I've met people like that, and there's so much power to that, and they don't have to say anything. They're just whole. Ellen White talks at length about, in several places, about how we could, right now, live in heaven, live in the very atmosphere of heaven, like we're actually living there. If we would have the kind of walk that Enoch had, where it just says very short in the genealogies, and Enoch walked with God a certain number of years after his son was born, and then he just wasn't, because God had taken him. And Ellen White says we can actually be in such constant, inseparable communion with God that it's when Jesus comes back, it won't even be like discontinuity for us. It will be just like, oh, okay, so now it's this way. Because we will have already been having the experience before the time. I would say she's describing enlightenment, and it probably it would involve, I mean, the neural correlates. I'm not saying that the brain is causing those things to happen, but it's at least reflecting it. Yeah, that's what it looks like when it happens when you look at the brain. So when you take LSD, probably what you're doing is causing the brain to get that way, and then you have the experience. Suppose what happened to Paul, or what Ellen White's talking about, is probably the other way around, or possibly. It looks that way, and then the brain, when you look at it, that's what you find, because it happened. Now, I'm not sure that there's a difference between those two things, actually, because keep in mind, as we've talked about before, if it's true that a day is as 1,000 years and means no difference to God, and he's the always having been, will be, and before Abraham was, I am, and all of that, if that's really true, then God would be occupying something more than just four dimensions. And if that's the case, there's no cause and effect in that next level. Because cause and effect is a construct that we've come up with when we're stuck in time's error. Because causes can't come after effect. It requires that we go in one direction, and in five dimensions, there's no such thing as that, just one dimension. Yes?
What do you say about enlightenment in relation or in comparison to optimism?
You could be optimistic in combat, but I don't think you could be in combat while you're enlightened. It would be very, very difficult to imagine that. I would say that people who are enlightened, I don't think they'd be pessimistic, but I'm not sure they'd be optimistic either. Because pessimism and optimism tend to be about the future. And people that are enlightened tend to occupy the infinity of the present. Remember we talked about if you are just totally in the moment? Did we talk about that? Let me make that one a little clearer again. Oh, yeah, I remember we did, because we talked about the human perceptual moment. Remember that? We talked about the human perceptual moment. I know we did, because somebody submitted Laura submitted a question from January 22 or something like that. I can't remember. Anyway, we were saying that human awareness, that when we sample with our senses or we sample even with our awareness, it's like making the picture of reality to us, and then comparing it to the last view so we see trends and all of that, our awareness, we like take a snapshot here, and then we have a snapshot there, and we have a snapshot here. So any events where you'd have like four or five of them between here and here, you cannot perceive them as five separate things. Even if it's just the movie is going the frames that fast, faster than human perceptual moment. Now there are some people whose perceptual moment is so much faster that they notice single frames in the movie. And there's things you can do that will make it so that you're sampling apparently more, you know, more frequently. You can train that, and then sort of the world outside of you seems like it's going in slow motion. That's what I was, why I was asked to learn to bounce and juggle super balls with chopsticks in jiu-jitsu. Because when you start out, it seems absurd, but after you do it for a few months, you find that what looks like is doing this to everybody else, when you get centered and you cause your nervous system to engage as it's been practicing, the ball appears to be, you know, moving about like this, and you kind of just reach out and take it. And you can juggle it and just, and everything seems to be in slow motion around you. So you have that, you're necessarily, if it appears that way, you necessarily must be sampling more frequently. Yes?
Why would someone want to say to see more frames per second
or whatever? There's some places where I don't think it would be of value. There's some places where I think it would be a hindrance. Because sometimes your best bet is to kind of tune out the circumstances and stay focused. But the key to this is that it's something that can be turned on and turned off at will when it's practiced enough. And when you'd want to do that, well, let's say somebody was falling and you wanted to catch them. I had a person who was a buddy of mine. He's still a buddy of mine. We were in the seminary together at Andrews University. And the back exit of the seminary is, it's not quite as wide as his classroom, but it's a good bit. It's pretty wide. There's several sets of doors, kind of like when you come out of the church. You know how wide come out the lobby of the seminary building and then go toward campus. Well, it was icy like crazy, and you couldn't see the ice. It was just little dusting of snow over it, and we couldn't see that it had iced up. And so I had many books, and I had a laptop case with a strap, and laptops then were really heavy. They had big lead acid batteries. I mean, they weighed as much as a desktop would weigh today, you know, a heavy thing. And I had my briefcase in the other hand and holding books, you know. So I've got trying to head over to the library to get rid of these books for a report I've written. And I'm coming out from the far left door, and Angelo is coming out from I was coming up far right, he was coming up far left as we were exiting. And when I hit the second step, my feet were just like this. And I mean, he was over there, all right? But before I hit the pavement, he was under me. I mean, like a wedge, and had a hold of me. I didn't even drop the books. He had completely a hold of me. He has moved from there to be under me in the time since he noticed that I was going upside down. And when I righted myself, I asked him what form of martial arts he studied. It turns out he was actually the founder of the New York City-based Art of Style. He was, since a child, a martial arts prodigy. There's one example. I mean, think about the YouTube videos that I've seen cropping up on Facebook of dads that have been able to catch their kids. I don't know, you you saw that one then. The dad, kids are like, you know, flying off the launcher, and the dad is like mystically underneath them like that. Well, it's like that, I guess, in practical terms. In martial arts, you can imagine a jillion ways that it would be really nice, because somebody could be striking you, and it seems to come slowly, and you can gently step out of the way. You don't have to do anything but just keep not being there, you know, in Aikido fashion. In any event, with this, let's get back. I was talking to Mr. Morgan. What was I answering? Because I want to get back to why I was referring again to the perceptual moment.
The original question was something you would say about the enlightenment in comparison to altruism.
Oh, right. Right. I got it. And I was saying optimism and pessimism are really like whether you take a positive or a negative approach to focusing on the future. But a person who is practicing some of these enlightened, and this is a typical thing of people that are enlightened also, they practice being present. They're not always reminiscing or dreading or worrying. Remember Jesus said, why are you worried about tomorrow? Don't you have enough troubles today? Have enough trouble to keep you busy? You got to worry. Can't you just keep it in one day at least? He said, you know, look at my other creatures. They're not worrying. Why are you always worrying? You're so he was basically telling people that you only get a moment at a time. You get one of these at a time. If the one that you have now isn't the one you're using, then you're actually never living. You're letting the ones that you're actually in go by. And there's so little you can do about the ones that haven't come yet or the ones that are behind you. There's so very little that you can do. At least now, at least in this state, we can see that nature is set up so that the past and the future aren't inaccessible, but they are inaccessible to our normal experience. So a person who's enlightened, actually, who kind of gets the Enoch thing, isn't even here. Because even this, even the snapshot of a moment, has to actually have some duration, or if there's no time that goes by. And if it doesn't, if it's zero time that goes by, it's like even when a camera takes a picture, the shutter's open for a moment, then it closes, right? Same thing with our awareness. We're sampling from here to here in, what are they, nanoseconds or milliseconds? But if somebody was actually letting zero time go by, that's probably what happened to him. He just wasn't. Because he was so in the present that the duration was zero. You know, rise over run gives you slope. If run is zero, you have a zero denominator error. That's undefined. So that means your very consciousness would be undefined. And that is kind of what some people are after with enlightenment, I think.
I took the LSD versus and
you took LSD?
No.
Don't take it.
No,
I've talked to people that are taking it, and some of them were lucky, but actually most of them really were unlucky about it.
But related to like LSD and like how we're talking about versus God's touching us kind of thing. So like in places like the Whirling Dervishes or like the just like Pentecostal or any kind of movement. Activity-based thing.
Or Ellen White in vision,
yeah.
In trance?
Well, yeah, that as well. But, like, how much do you think of that is, like, God influence as opposed to, like, influence? Because if you look through, like, let's say, like, a rock concert and there's, like, a mosh pit or, like, some, I don't know.
Sure.
Like, that's also...
Yes,
like,
rock concerts
in my mind, this
yeah.
is kind of the same thing. So, like, what?
Yeah.
What's the difference?
Ecstasy.
Yeah.
Before it was used for a party drug, it was being used... for couples therapy, right? It was because it hyperactivates oxytocin, production and yep. receptor sites.
That one.
And so people that were intractably alienated, that were in important relationships, were taking it together, and they were taking it under controlled circumstances, and they walked away without detectable side effects that, at least they weren't documented. It was a very positive thing. And so what they went into it looking for affected what came out of it, even with similar purity and doses. When you do it to screw around, when you do it to get to, you know, to just as escapism or entertainment, or to just really have a mind-blowing hedonistic experience, it blow your mind. Plus, they were doing it once. People who were using LSD clinically, people who were have experimented even in using mushrooms and ayahuasca for PTSD. They don't talk about developing a habit of it. They talk about just doing it and then you've done it. One researcher, one hallucinogen researcher said, if you knock on a door and then somebody lets you in, you don't go back and keep knocking on the door all the time. You're already in. Just don't do that. So he said, you know, you used it. Move along. You've got the experience. If it wasn't what you're looking for, then you found out it's not going to do it for you.
No, but like, say like the whirling dervishes. Like, I'm using that for
well, they keep doing it.
Yeah, but like, what part of that is related to, like, you know, is God touching them or influencing them, as opposed to like us just getting enough people to all start chanting and start spinning in circles,
well,
and then we'll have the effect of God.
Well, when you ask for God, did God do it? Did God, I guess you're asking, did God come into our four dimensions and make a cause?
Yeah.
Because realize if there's no cause and effect, then who does anything?
Yeah.
Is there agency? If there's no cause and effect, you're not the cause. How do you be doing anything? You just exist, and things all just exist. Remember when it talked about in the Old Testament God hardened Pharaoh's heart? Do you think God made Pharaoh spiteful? Did you think he did? Well, the Israelites thought he did, because they actually believed that God was making everything happen. We have sort of in our cartoons, we sort of have a devil on a shoulder and an angel on a shoulder and everything. There's various degrees of not wanting to just take responsibility for our own, you know, for what happens. Some things just happen. Now, did God make my chalk fall? Or is it just that's the way things are structured, the way they were created? Were they purposely created? I believe that they were. But some things, you know, that the Adventist version of explaining that atheist maker question, that terrible question of how there can be an all-powerful, all-loving, all-knowing, everywhere present God, and yet innocent people suffer. Little babies are born with birth defects. Terrible spina bifida or something. They're just insides are on the outside when they come out. I mean, come on. How can so that people ask that question and they say, so it's absurd to them, in their worldview, that there could be this God. Well, Seventh-day Adventists have answered that with our model of the Great Controversy. We tell about this war in heaven. Before there was any conflict of any kind, nobody challenged anybody, and God was giving everybody everything they needed, but truly had made everybody free. And so then this war started, and so now God is not willing to just, you know, nip it in the bud, because then people are going to go, oh, he's a terrorist, you know, he's not a loving God. We'll look at that more when we talk about the algebra of evil. But that's premised on things are running their course right now. Prove what it is with sin in the system. So if they're running their course to prove it, how much do we want God to come in and monkey around with it so it doesn't run its course and then the proof isn't there? There's no tension there, isn't there?
culture that was around them for so long, because so many of them believe that in thinking of things in a deterministic way, where they thought that the gods caused everything, so if they prayed for rain, that God would cause the rain to fall for them.
Yeah.
And so in that sense, they were kind of thinking still in, like, they misrepresented who God was.
Absolutely. That polytheistic thing, we usually say pagan. We use that term, but paganism is usually polytheistic. But we do that today. You know, when we're praying for God to intervene in our behalf, when God has not intervened in our neighbor's behalf, and we say, "Oh, thank you for protecting me, even though it sucks for them, but whatever it is, you're a good God." I guess their God isn't a good God, but our God is a good God. Until it happens to us, then, I don't know, some of us will say, maybe our God's not a good God, and other people will say, well, he's teaching us a lesson. We needed this. He's still a good God. It's non-falsifiable. That's the problem with the scientific method and faith.
Yeah.
There's no facts that you can present to that model. It's like that spokesperson, that blonde lady who's been on all the news shows for the new president. There's nothing you can say so that she's going to say, oh yeah, you got me. Never. And we're like that. But there's some upsides to that, to being like that. There are some upsides to being like uberly optimistic. Now we're back to the optimistic. We are thinking about the future and the past. We're not living right in the moment. If we are, I'd rather be optimistic. Well, I guess unless I'm smelling smoke and I'm overly optimistic and saying, that's probably not anything burning in here. Meanwhile, all my exits are getting blocked. Right, Laura?
How should we be a realist coming into that?
Realist? Realist is something pessimists call themselves usually. Almost everybody that's a realist is just a pessimist, and they don't like the term. Think about that. How many times does someone say, no, I'm just being a realist, and they're going, no, you're being an optimist. Think about that. Pessimists hate to hear that.
It's horrifying. I
That's a good point. And it turns out, if you take sophomores, which are like, it's always sophomores that are the psychology lab people, right? You always get a bunch of sophomores, right? Because they haven't taken the class yet, but you're not using freshmen because you can't find them anyway. So it's always sophomores. So if you take a group of sophomores when you're in psychology class and you give somebody $20, and they hold it $20, and then you tell them if they can stand a certain amount of electrical shock, they can keep the $20. And they will let you ramp that thing up there until you're tasing their tail to the ground. But if you tell them, there's a $20 bill right there, you see it? You go put it on the shelf, and you say, all you have to do is get a shock, and then you can have it. They go, I'm out. Even if it's a smaller shock, I'm out. And they say, well, I'll try it. And they get a little, and they go, and it's going to be more. And you go, I'm out. But if you put it in their hand, so I think that's related to what you're saying, at least the part of the brain that does that. If you have the glass and you've had a drink of it, it's different than if you have nothing and then someone gives you half. Turns out also that if you look at the capacity for empathy, you test people by seeing what areas light up in their brain. Test people for oxytocin levels, that sort of thing. Test people for their answers to dilemmas and that sort of thing. All the ways that we test empathy, if you test people that are really wealthy and compare them to the tests of people who have modest or low incomes, you find that people that are uber wealthy as a group are extremely less capable physically of empathy. They don't feel it. So you can say, how can you do that to people? Don't you know what it makes them feel like? whereas somebody from of less means, they're like, "Nah, you can't do that. I mean, that think of what that would make them do." And then they experience what it would be like to be in those people's shoes. But that doesn't happen for the very wealthy. I don't know whether it's because they're wealthy that they get like that, or it's because they're like that that they're able to get wealthy, because they can go on thingifying people and letting people hurt for their advantage. But I don't know. Not everybody that's wealthy has hurt people. If you write a book on how to be nice to people and it flies off the shelf and it's, you know, $9 and you sell millions of them, you're wealthy. But who did you hurt? You didn't hurt anybody. You know, it just happened. So I don't know whether they sorted it out for all of that stuff. But in any event, right now, in our unenlightened state, in our semi-enlightened states, in our various degrees of enlightenment, we still need some categories because it allows us to make a picture of things. We have trouble making pictures of things if we don't have some categories. If I try to describe the way my dog looks, and you've never seen my dog, I'm going to tell you, well, it's a German Shepherd, so now you make a picture of a German Shepherd. But it's not that kind that has tan on it. He doesn't have any. It's almost all black, except he's got a little bit of reddish, rusty color, all right? And he's got a tiny little bit of rust around his eyes, like a mask, and then a little bit down here, just almost, you barely can see it, but it means his face isn't completely jet black. Like, we did have one that was solid black, but this one has got a little rust. And then his feet have got some red hair down here, just mixed and a little bit lighter. And that's about it. The rest of him is black. Now, you can picture him. I can even describe some things like his toenails are almost all solid black. And on his tongue, it's all pink, but he has a birthmark. When he sticks it out about halfway down, he's got a birthmark about the size of a nickel. It's a little bit oval. Right down there, it's a black spot on his tongue. And he's kind of... not a long-haired shepherd, but he's real full. He looks like a black wolf would look. So now you can picture that, but you've never seen it, right? So that's something that you could make a picture of if you could see it. But there are some topics that you can't just show a picture. But how can you picture what a philosophy looks like? You know, what color is it? You know, what does it smell like? Does it shed? I hope my philosophy sheds all over everybody, but they can't get it off of. So what we want to do, though, is we want to look at some of the categories of philosophy. We've seen, and we're going to see some more, that the pre-Socratics were really concerned with some things like, you know, what's even real? What is there? What's stuff made up of? You know, what's the nature of reality? Do things change or do they stay the same? What are they made out of? I think that they wondered how they came about. I think they wondered how it all got to be what it is. But first of all, one of the major branches of philosophy is metaphysics. Metaphysics, and I know we've said this before, but I want to repeat it so that if anyone didn't get it, or even if you did, it'll help lock it in. Metaphysics has become its own term, and we kind of think of it as like stuff that doesn't fit into real physics or something, you know. We go back to the Greek word, and the meta is like after, you know, or aside from. And so when something's a meta function, you know, we think, okay, it's over and above. So this is like beyond, over and above physics. That isn't where it came from at all. The only reason it got called that is that Aristotle wrote a book called Physics, which means physics. We translate that into English, physics. And all he meant was, I'm describing the physical world and how I see things happening in the physical world. It's just, I'm talking about physical reality, the world of rocks and desks and water and air and things that are physical. I'm just going to write about the physical world, the sort of the natural world. And then he finished that book, and then he said, you know, there's some other things I want to talk about, too. It's kind of like I told you first about the German Shepherd, and then I said, now picture what philosophy looks like. Well, philosophy is intangible. It's not part of the physical world, like a dog. A dog is made up of physical stuff, but philosophy is not made up of physical stuff. So after he wrote the book, Mussis, he wrote another book. And you know what he called it? The book I wrote after the book called Mussis. After Physics. And that happens to be Metaphysics. Metaphysics. That's all. That's all that came, that it meant for him to give it that title was Book 2. After the physics book. After the physical. So, metaphysics, though, you get a sense of the flavor of it when I tell you that illustration of picture my dog, and I can describe his physical parts and tell you how much he weighs and how tall he is and what colors he is and what kind and all that stuff. But then philosophy doesn't fit into that. Neither does love. Love doesn't fit in that. So, metaphysics, first of all, is stuff that doesn't, you can't ever just describe it easily with tangibility. You can't get your teeth into it. The first branch underneath metaphysics, the first subsection, is ontology. Okay? And ontology, as we've talked about before, is just what's real. It's the nature of reality, of existence, isness. Okay? And what is it to exist instead of not to exist? What is it? Can you think of something that you can't quite tell if it exists? Can you? How about a belch? Does a belch exist? Somebody burps real loud? What was it play like? It came from Harry Potter. It didn't actually happen. It was fiction, or it really happened. What is it? But if it was 5 minutes ago, does it still exist? Well, that depends on what you mean by exist. Right? Does my reputation exist? Well, what's it mean to exist? Do I exist? Does my mind exist? Do I have a consciousness, or am I a consciousness? What does it even mean for me to exist? Well, skepticism is one approach to ontology. Nihilism goes beyond where you actually have a commitment to say that nothing exists. It's not just that I doubt that things exist. It's where a nihilist would say that nothing actually exists. It's all playlike. It isn't. It all isn't. Things that come from nihilism, if you're really committed, if you really believe that, and we'll go back to Angela's question, now what do we do? So how am I supposed to live if nothing exists? Or if I doubt that I even exist, then does anything matter? Does it matter what I do? Or if I'm doing it, am I really doing it? I don't know. Tell the jury and see if they are happy with that. Is that what physics teaches us, that your perception of it doesn't change whether it's there or not?
Well, like, if I decide that the desk isn't here, like, does that really matter if the desk is really there or not?
But you believe the desk is there. What if you believed it wasn't? I mean, what if you really believed it wasn't?
Didn't we read a chapter on that in one of the books? That it's because that, or like, someone believed that it's because of us that things actually exist.
Exactly.
Like
constructivist.
After we leave, like a certain mountain, is it still there?
Uh huh.
After we leave.
Constructivism. Absolutely. Let me pay you. I'll be right over there. Just a little. thing people have said that they are. And there's some really, really smart people, and they've asked some questions that are really hard to dismiss. That's a really tough call, isn't it? But we do know this much. Little particles, if we hold them accountable, we don't just let them go and just let them blend together and say, oh, we're not. We look at just one. If you decide by taking a measurement to become a conscious of it, then it's a little piece of stuff, then it is. But if you do the other way and say, no, it's just a wave, it's just a doing, it's not a thing, then you're right about that too. And it would be like downstream from then on, as long as it exists, it's now locked in. And the quantum Zeno effect that we talked about earlier, watching to see if a radioactive particle that should decay, you know, you give it enough time, it should have decayed way, 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 way past its half-life. And you're watching it to see it, and your observation locks it in so it won't do it while you're looking. And you can train it by looking at it and then going away for a second and getting back before it does, and like keeping it from, with classical conditioning, when you vary the reward and vary the punishment so that it's less easily extinguished by withdrawing the feedback later on, you make it durable. It's the same thing with those little particles that could have decayed when they're unstable, but you train them. This is bizarre. And that's actually physical reality. How does that work? And why is it like that? I don't know. Nobody does. Nobody knows. So under ontology, there's, ready for this? Ready for this? I'm going to say them. You can write them down if you want, but I'm just going to say them, and they'll be on the recording and everything, but I'm not going to take the time to write them down. Under ontology, which is the study of existence or of being, there's cosmology, the world and all, cosmology, the study of the world and all phenomena in space and time. And then there's cosmogony, the origin of the universe. Then there's identity and change. What is the identity of something? Do things have an identity? Like, if you're looking at two entangled particles, are you actually just looking at one particle that's showing up in two places at the same time? Or are you looking at two different particles? That's a hard question. Isn't that a hard question? Plus, what makes a person a person? If you have a head injury and your personality changes entirely, are you the same person?
Yeah, just different moods.
Oh, you have no memories. Complete amnesia, you start over. Complete retrograde amnesia, you start over. And your temperament is just unrecognizable. You don't know if you don't have any history in your mind. Other people have a history with you. Are you the same person?
Define what the person is.
That's right. You'd have to define what it is. And what isness is. Identity is a bummer. Plus, Buddhists believe that you're not the same person from moment to moment. Because however you define me right now, part of it has to be the physical arrangement of all the atoms and particles in me, right? And all their trajectories. My physical state is part of it. Okay, it changed. When I was saying that, now I'm not that. Now I'm not that. Plus, if you knew me when I was a student here, when I started when I was 16 in 1979, and then you look at me now, am I the same person? Do I have the same opinions? Would I vote the same way? Do I treat people the same way? Do I believe all the same things? Do I even look the same? Am I the same person? Yeah, well, when you go through the, when you go into the, what's the thing called that beams you down to the planet on the Enterprise? What's the thing called? The transporter, thank you, Laura. When you go in the transporter and they disassemble all of your atoms, which are just information, and then they transmit the information. And then they use that information to just arrange you exactly the way you arranged, and then are you the same entity? Because if you're the same entity, then what if that device, when it took you apart and put you over here, what if it then still had that information and made you there also? Or just made two copies of you? Would you then be the same person?
Not the same question they try to answer with the ship of Theseus.
Yes. Very, very good point. The ship of Theseus is a legendary ship that goes on multi-year campaigns. And as it's traveling, it has to stop at each available port and make repairs. So planks have split and gotten rotten, and they've hit sandbars with them, and they have to pull planks off everywhere. And so over time, they've taken every board off of the ship and replaced it. But the crew always gets back on, although they always take on new crew and leave crew off, too. That's dynamic. And by the time they come back, there might be two or three people who started the voyage, or half of them, or whatever. But every board, and every bit of paint, and every nail has been changed. But it's a little bit at a time. So when it comes back, it still says, Theseus, is it the same ship? It's not one board the same. Plus, what if you have been following along in another ship, and every time they pulled a board off, you took it, and you mark it, and you stowed it in your cargo hold. And then when you get back, you put it all together, and it might be rickety, because some of it's all kind of rotten, but you build it back with the same boards. Which one is the ship of Theseus? So that's a toughie. And you and I, every decade or so, pretty much all the atoms are changed down. There's none of the atoms that have continuity that we had, you know, 10 years ago. How about that?
Jeez. Isn't the defining like the what a human is like with the losing all your memories and everything, like kind of the same thing that they run into with like abortion, like because there's no memory. So what?
Right.
What do they have?
And how about people with Alzheimer's? So they don't know you. Are they not? They're not a person now. They can't make memories. Are they not a person?
Are you saying they are?
Oh no, I'm not saying they're not. I'm saying that the definition of a person is a really hard, gnarly, non-straightforward proposition. Think the definition of person is a construct that we've come up with to try to describe something that probably defies completely making rational, consistent sense in four dimensions, because it's fact. The fact of our person is actually involves some five-dimensional connections. To actually believe consciousness itself is something that is not occurring, limited to four dimensions. I suspect the factuality of something, at least parts of the Stuart Hameroff, Roger Penrose, Orc OR theory of consciousness that says that in the microtubules in our nervous system, that there's actually quantum effects going on, and that what's happening, those quantum effects probably involve some things that include entangled particles, probably include like something like subspace transmission. There's things going on where, like, our actual personness probably resides in a cloud that's at least five dimensions. And our four-dimensional representation is what we're seeing in our nervous system is probably more resembling, like, an antenna. Like, when you don't buy Microsoft Office anymore to live as software on your hard drive. It just exists in the cloud. And you store everything in Dropbox or in Google Drive or whatever. It doesn't even live on your computer. It looks like it does, but it doesn't. If you cut it off from the internet, you got nothing. So if you cut us off from the outer net, I think you'd have nothing. And so a lot of these questions are going to be mysterious, and they're going to look illogical, like tesseracts don't make geometric sense to us. They break the rules of Euclidean geometry for us. Okay, the Chip of Theseus was a great illustration. And then matter, what the heck is matter? We talked about that. We dissected the daylights out of that. I'll hammer on that some more. Consciousness and the mind-matter relationship. We talked a little bit about that. How could a thought cause particles to stuff, physical hardware, bones? How could bones be moved by thought? Thought doesn't have any mass. Thought isn't something you can weigh on a scale. So if you throw thought against it, you haven't thrown anything against it. Now I showed you with this radiometer that when I shine light on it, the light actually behaves as a particle with mass and causes the thing to move. See if this is even powerful enough. The light probably is. I might need to get more powerful light to make it work. This one's really tired. Okay.
Sit down.
I didn't bring a powerful enough light this time. Oh, the phone light. I like it to be waterproof, sitting in the hot tub.
I think so.
I write papers in the hot tub. My iPad has got one of these cases too, man. And my tub is waterproof. Wow. Let's see, flashlight.
Yes,
it's broken. Oh, there it goes. Barely. Wow, it doesn't like LED light as much as it likes incandescent light. I barely got it to move. It's like these guys that claim that they have telekinetic abilities, and then the amazing Randy shows that they don't.
How many dollars did you give me?
Can guess it?
Yeah.
Give you a curse dollar if you can guess my iPhone password.
7311.
No. But what did you give me one? What? That's not it, but good. No. You just saw me do it in thought for the thumb position. Man, you're gonna have to be better than that if you're gonna be scanning people's pins of air. Oh, anyway. So how is it that a thought can make my arm move? If people say that the mind is just what the brain does, okay, I'm having a thought. How can the thought cause my arm to go up? I'm thinking about it going up, up it goes. Wow, where does it happen? Well, Rene Descartes said that there was a special little miracle organ in the brain called the pineal gland. And the pineal gland, he said, the reason he thought it was a special little deal is that it was something he could see that wasn't showing bilateral symmetry. It only existed in the middle. And it existed kind of where he thought God would come and make a miracle. That was his, and then a miracle happened, a little spot. But it turns out that the pineal gland has important functions, but they're a little less theologically romantic than where God makes the miracle happen of that interface between the non-physical and the physical. It turns out that the pineal gland probably has something to do with kind of a timing function. What's that? Yeah, it does involve some melatonin, so that's one of the means that it uses to help regulate our cycles, our time cycles, daily sleep-wake stuff. Yeah, and some other stuff. It's kind of probably what gets biffed with when you have jet lag. You know, it's very interesting, just not as interesting as God is coming down there every time you want to move your finger to play the flute. It's not as interesting. Determinism and free will. We talked about that already, remember? Talked about if everything is just following all the rules and things actually function like with cause and effect instead of like, oh, and then it breaks a rule here, and then it breaks a rule there. I let go of the chalk. I'm not sure if it's going to fall. It might go up. It might float around. It might, like, go to the board, spell a couple of your names, make a smiley face, and then come back, fall, jump back up, and get my hand. But usually it falls. That just happens. Stuff is supposed to work like that. We're not watching it going, oh, that was a miracle. And we take data, and there was a miracle. I mean, for the most part, don't we believe that kind of when something bumps into something, it moves with the amount of energy that was lost from the kinetic energy of the object that hit it. And when something is attracted by a force, it's attracted to the degree that proportional to the magnitude of the force, and typically to the negative inverse of the square of the difference, the square of the distance between the centers of their mass, right? I mean, that's how we expect forces to operate. We don't know what it means, like magnetism and that sort of thing, or the weak or strong nuclear force. We don't have any idea how anything attracts anything, gravity or magnetism. I don't know what that is. We don't have any idea. It's spooky, weird stuff that happens without touching. That's really as scientific as we can get about it. Isn't that amazing? We get this far. With all of our amazing science, we go put a couple of footprints and litter a little bit, leave some crap on the moon. We just don't even know what forces are. We don't have any idea. Any more than the pre-Socratics did before we even had what we call science today. So if it's all just spinning like a big machine, making sense instead of having little miracles here and there, then how do we actually have any actual free choice? How is there any free choice? You think our brains just run around breaking the laws of nature? That's a little miracle machine. That's where we have an exception. If you watch it, it's like, oh, it doesn't make any sense at all. Electrical impulse from here, and it just disappears? No, we can trace it from where it starts. We can watch an image come into a retina, and then we can trace it back along the optic nerve. We can go back to the occipital lobe, and we can watch with some poor cat with his skull off and his head hanging out, and we can say, okay, oh, cool, this is the place where, right here, okay, this tissue right here, this nerve, these neurons, this little group of neurons here, this happens to be where the cat can pick out straight up and down lines. And then this one over here is where the cat can pick out the kind of go this way. And then, oh, this is where it can tell light from dark. And we can do, it's very mechanical. So if it's all mechanical, the way the brain works and everything, isn't it one big system that's following, I mean, very complicated. There's just zillions of particles and forces. But isn't the arrangement of them following the laws of nature? And if it is, then how do you actually have any free will? If it's all set up following the rules, before you were born, the rules should have already constrained everything that was going to happen. Everything is inevitable. Does that bother you? Fortunately, we find that we were wrong about that. We were wrong. Because that required us to use like the billiard ball high school physics model of how things move and attract each other and follow cause and effect. It turns out that when you look to the very, very small, to the very, very small, the very, very fast, when you break it down enough, you find out that constituently, that fundamentally, it isn't following those kind of rules at all. It's following the rules that we kind of put under the blanket now of quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics is, you can go, okay, let's watch. This should make that happen. Ah, oh, it didn't happen. Let's see. Oh, now it happened. Oh, why then and not? We don't know. So it comes down to something that doesn't make Newtonian kind of sense, like Isaac Newton said it did. It just doesn't. And so there's debates about whether quantum mechanics is actually random or deterministic. And some people argue that even quantum mechanics is deterministic. We just can't get there to see what it's like the formula behind the scene for quantum mechanics is too complex. It's like pseudo-random, but it isn't truly random. But the discussion today actually is whether it's random or whether it's deterministic, which means following the rules predetermined before you have any choice. But notice, neither of those two options, random, like there's no way to predict it, or it's all set up in advance, can't get out of it. Neither of those two choices that people are arguing are, in my opinion at least, the real choice, which means actually, you and I actually have free will. Not pseudo-free will. I believe we have absolute free will. That we can pick that we're truly free. I really believe that. And here's how I believe it scientifically. I believe it theologically, yes. But it goes in more than one direction, not just theology for me. Here's part of the reason people say no. This is the timeline, okay? This is a very small amount of time. This is when we monitor my brain or your brain, put somebody in an fMRI or a PET scan or whatever. We want to see what's the order of events when somebody is having the experience of deciding to do something and then doing it. Okay? So here, I'll use a color. The pink for the things that we're, like the experience, the phenomenology of it. I'll use the pink for that, okay? And I'll use the blue for the things we're measuring, all right? So the pink is kind of like how you and I would perceive it, and that's like, oh yeah, I saw that in our mind. And this is like what they see in the fMRI. What the computer says happened in this order, like one thing happens, then the next thing happens. So here's how that goes. So you have first, here on the timeline, you have what looks like an intention because things start getting set up to act. Okay, you have it like that. Now, there's nothing pink yet. We haven't had any experience yet. Okay, after that happens, then we go, you know what? You know what I'm going to do? So we choose, we experience choosing to act. Like that. Okay? Then, in the real world, we act. So this gives people, the brain scientists say, this gives people the false impression. It fakes them out. It deludes them into thinking that they had a choice about it. Because what they say is that this is actually just one of those steps in setting it up to do the action. Makes you think you made a choice. Now, some of the other steps that occur are like sending things to the motor cortex and all of that. represent the act, and we have a whole bunch of other things to get actions done. But because of this order, people have said that they believe we don't really have free will. Now, I'm going to say something that you might choose to say is just ridiculous, but here's how I think this is actually occurring. Because we respond in almost real time to things, I believe that when we choose, when we make a choice to act, that we actually, at that moment, impact the past. Because our consciousness is actually functioning in observe, now they're actually observably quantum mechanical, there are observable quantum mechanical functions in microtubules that Hameroff and Penrose predicted. Those have actually been seen in the laboratory now, in actual microtubules. Yes, it is. This is, but it's, but I'm saying that it happens as possibly as the very fundamental basis of how we're conscious and living lives. Like, it's not just weird stuff that, that affects 6 months ago when you arranged all the fish. This happens and we don't get to see how it happens. Even hooking up to brain scanners is really outside of the norm. I mean, how often do you get hooked up to an fMRI or to a PET scanner? I mean, is that pretty normal for you? Go, I wonder what it looks like when I'm blow drying my hair. I kind of like to see what it looks like when I'm blow drying my hair. That would be really something, wouldn't it? How about you? Similar look. So determinism and free will. You see that that's a pregnant topic. There's a lot that could come from that. We're so just scratching. I could teach a major, not just a course, just in that topic. And it would be awesome. I'd love it too. Necessity and possibility. And theology and spirituality. Those things are all ontological, all under ontology. Now, next main category is epistemology. We've talked about that before. Okay, I'm going to say 1 through 8. There's more than 8. I just listed 8 examples. Yeah, I just listed 8 examples. E.g., okay, not E.g. White, but like, for example. B, epistemology. Okay, epistemology is the study of knowledge. Everybody got sick of it at the same time. Unless they said something that simultaneously offended a whole cadre of our class members. All at once, too. I thought I'd kind of get that, like, spotty.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Cosmology, cosmogony, identity and change. That's one, identity and change. Matter is 4. 5 is consciousness and mind and the mind-matter relationship. 6 is determinism and free will, volition, in parentheses, volition. Another term for free will, like volitional behavior is behavior you do that you have a choice about. 7 is necessity and possibility. And 8, theology and spirituality. Okay? Now, moving to B, epistemology. 1, does knowledge have a D in it? I think it does. Knowledge. There's lots of kinds of knowledge. Okay? And they exist in different parts of the brain, actually. I can have data kind of knowledge. I can know that, you know, Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492 or whatever. I can know the words to some song. I can know your names. And a couple of you said, how come you know all of our names, like by the second class period? How do you do that? So that's just information. I know phone numbers of lots of people. I know dates, the periodic table, a bunch of stuff like that. Bible verses, facts about theology, the names of these people we talk about, the pre-Socratics and all through Western, you know, that's just, it's just data. Wikipedia knows that, I mean, has that information. But then there's another kind of knowing, and it's like, you had a Rubik's Cube the other day. You could know how to solve a Rubik's Cube, or how to ride a skateboard, or how to ride a bike, how to fly a plane. And seriously, am I the only one here that knows how to fly a plane? Oh, you know how to fly a plane. Oh, you did. Are you going to fly a plane?
Without dying? Ideally, I
you have the time for whatever you have the same amount of time as everybody else.
Speed up to lift on the ground, right?
So I guess you were gonna.
I've been on simulators.
You've been on simulators.
Yes.
Cool. Oh right. You know what's really cool? My son-in-law is a COBRA pilot, and so, like, for birthday, Christmas, a couple times when I've been where he's stationed, he's gotten me a few hours of combat simulator. Kind of like that. And a couple of years ago, my brother is a director of a sim program at Flight System Corporation in New Jersey for the Falcon 10 and Falcon 50. And he got all the pilots in the family for Christmas. He got us each an hour on the jet sims. It was most outstanding. What's that? Well, you'd be in trouble. No, I mean, I could, you know, if the pilot fell out, I could land it. I think I could. It wouldn't be pretty, but it wouldn't probably fail either. You know, I'd be talking a lot. I'd be getting some guidance, but I'd know what they meant. So I have certain things that I know how to do, and so do you. Those are different. It's a different kind of knowledge. But it's still worth studying. It's still important. How do we know how to do that? We don't know how we know. We really don't. We don't know how we know stuff, you know, information. We don't know how to do things. Strange. And there's another kind of knowledge. Knowledge, like, of our acquaintances. That's one thing that I could say your names on the second day of class, and some of you I've never met before. You know? I never met you before. I never met you before. But I knew your name. You know, I was able to call you by name on the way up the stairs, the third class period. Is that correct? Very correct. And I had it right. Yes?
Yeah.
But I didn't know you. If I come off acting like I know you, that's absurd. And if I did know you, it wouldn't just be absurd. It'd be creepy. It would really be creepy, wouldn't it? This is bad enough that I knew your name. He's going, I don't know, man. Middle-aged white cop is what it is. But I've been out of that game since 2005. So I haven't had anything to do with that since 2005. But I'm getting a sense of several people here. I'm studying your reactions to things. I'm hearing what you say. I'm seeing what you smile at and what you get bored at and everything. Same thing with you and you. I mean, I can tell you some things about you. Now I can probably do some things that would go, oh, now it's a parlor trick. You know, like you did the car trick, now it's like reading people. I could probably characterize some of you and tell you what your temperaments are. And I could ask a couple questions. And then I think I could tell everybody here who they were attracted to, everyone else here. I'm pretty sure I could do that. Because it's actually very formulaic. There's been a few questions, and I could just keep track of them, and then I'd go, oh. And I can come up with four letters,
yes.
And then I can just do the, and then find the people that it matches. But then I still don't really know you, do I? We'd have to be friends and have a relationship for me to know you. I've known Kyler for a long time. Now I can say, in some ways, for nobody else here, I know Kyler. In in some ways that I don't even know some of my own friends, because the relationship we have, there are some ways that we have experienced one another that goes beyond. Maybe we know each other better than some people know, like their brother or sister, because we spent several years doing jiu-jitsu together. And you get a sense of the other person. You know a whole aspect about their personhood that you can't get any other way. Is that true? And he knows me in ways that nobody else here does. And ways that my own brothers and my dad don't know. So there's this all these ways we can know each other. That we can, I don't know, how do you define it? But you can set it up your own. You can say, well, for me, knowing somebody is, and you're the authority, you can have it be that way. You can define it however you want. Say, you don't know me. You don't know me. So-and-so knows me. Say, on what basis? I just know. See, you don't have to make any sense with it. It's up to you.
One time I had just one of those moments where you scratch your head and maybe you fall apart without knowing it. But somebody, scratch their throat scratching me, and their mannerism. I'm like, but I know that person. And I turn around and they're there. And it was expected of them to come to that event. But once they sound, it's
yeah, you've got some anger, right? Yeah. You've got some things that are cues.
Like voice would also, but
or maybe even just getting one or two molecules that they gave off.
If I could perceive it.
You do perceive it. It could be that you actually do perceive it. And do some bizarre calculations. I picked on you actually.
She thought it was like free.
You didn't know that all that time on the mat is going to somehow translate into participation in philosophy. Never even thought about it. So, think about all the ways that you can know things. You can have cognizance of something or somebody. My point isn't to tell you all the ways that you can do it, just to say today that it all falls under epistemology and under knowledge. Now, belief. Talked about belief. Now, if you have faith in something that you don't have physical evidence for, you really have actual belief, you have actual faith. Remember, we talked about, you said you can make the desk disappear? And I said, but do you actually believe you can? The trouble is that you don't. If you actually believe that you could, then you might be able to. I don't know. I'm not able to be that convinced that I can. But I am convinced that there have been and probably are people that are able.
How do you get that belief?
I don't know, but Jesus seemed kind of hard on the disciples, like they should have stayed up studying later or put the time in the gym or something. It's like, oh man, you tiny little man, what are you afraid of? I'm trying to take a nap here. Gosh, I've been with you this long, you tiny little faith people. I mean, he's really on those guys, and I'm going, oh, I wouldn't have had it either. But then Peter stepped out of the boat. He did it. I don't know if I would. Well, that's what Jesus said. Jesus said that she believed if she had just the tiniest little bit of faith, what faith actually is, she could say to a mountain, you go jump into the lake and it will go. And I believe that. There is magic that is an illusion, and then there's magic that simply is the laws of nature that we haven't explained yet, that aren't orthodox anymore. If you and I could go back 200 years and show people what we're doing with our iPhones, what kind of magic would that be? That would be the kind that would get our butts killed. I mean, burning. What's for dinner? Oh, Kurtz and Luna. Am I right? Let's see. So, I want to make it really clear. I don't actually believe that faith is like sort of a dumbed-down version for superstitious people, and then knowledge and science is something for actually smart people. Depending on how you look at it, being able to tell things to happen and then they happen that people can't even explain is a little bit higher function than being able to explain the few things that we can explain. I mean, if I really could just do that and do the Yoda thing and the piano would just, like, I could put it around the room and you're going, keep focus, when it's over the top of you, and then I set it back down and I play it at a distance, you're going, some of you would go, okay, that's Satan. And others would be going, that's a little better than just being able to give a little lecture on how to build this thing. Understanding all the physics of the acoustics and everything, that's all cool. But the dude just lifted it up from over there. That would be a pretty high function. When Jesus said to the dead, rotten guy who had maggots and stunk already, he said, let's go. And he came up and he said, well, unwrap him. See, I'm more impressed by that than somebody who really is a thanatologist. That can really describe all the things about cadavers. There's a book about the life of that secret life of cadavers. I'm impressed by that, but not nearly as impressed as if they could just walk in the morgue and say, you stop that, get up and get on with your business, and the things all get up. It's like, now that's a higher function. So I don't want you to think that when I say knowledge and belief are not the same thing. You don't know something just because you believe it. You don't just because you believe it real hard and you say, I know, it doesn't mean you know. Knowing is a tough thing. It's a tough thing. You remember what Socrates found out about it? There wasn't any.
Well, I think that's interesting because when the Bible talks about a relationship with God, you know, a lot of times it perceives as you believe in him first, then you get to know him better.
Yeah.
The knowledge is second after belief.
And there's a certain experience thing which is empirical. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. I mean, the same part of us in our awareness is where you put the scientific data. It's we become aware of it because we, you know, we experienced it through our senses. But then if I experience something on the inside, then you go, ah, no. Like, what if on the inside I said, God, I want you to let me see. And it's something I couldn't see. I want you to put in my mind a vision of whatever. And he lets me see it. It's in my association cortex. I get it. I'm having the experience, but it's not out here because it hasn't happened yet. So if it hasn't happened yet, then maybe it's conditional. Is prophecy conditional? If prophecy is not conditional, then we have the volition and the predetermined problem. But it turns out that it is pretty much, isn't it? Remember, the whole business, everyone's hung up on Israel is God's people. Because God said, forever, it will be me and Israel. It's like, well, you know, the people have said, forever, you're going to be my spouse, and then they're more interested in relations with everyone else in town instead of their spouse, and then forever becomes short. That's kind of the illustration he used. He said, you weren't interested in intimacy with me, you were interested in whoring all over the place. And that's what Hosea, the book of Hosea is about. Well, I don't want to be called to a Hosea ministry. Dude, that's bad times. I'd rather have to be the one, the prophet who had to spend, you know where I'm going with this? Had to spend 1 year with his butt hanging out there as a testimony to everybody when the Assyrians came and took them, or the Babylonians took them, they were going to be walking with bare bottom all the way to where they're going to get stored when they got turned into slaves. So the prophet was commanded to walk around booty naked for a year. That was his ministry as a prophet. I'd rather do that than Hosea, but I'm going to sign up for either of them. They're bad. Yes, Hosea was bad. Okay, truth. Yeah, well, what do you mean? What does it mean, truth? Or fact? Alternate truth, alternate fact? We're having this discussion. It circles back around, though. If we believe something hard enough, does it become real? So if you say, no, what I'm talking about when I say the truth is how it really is, it turns out that it's not as simple as to have an actuality of something as things really are. It turns out that it depends on where you stand and who it is that's experiencing it in some really bizarre ways that you can prove in the laboratory. And you can prove them, don't even have to be in the laboratory. Some things about nature and stuff are actually real in one person's reference frame, and real in a different way, different order of events even, in another person's reference frame. And that is as real as it gets. There's no point, the magical reference point, the trump card, pardon me for that, there's no actual, this is the factual way things are. There's, because there's no authoritative location of observation in the universe. Every one of them is just as good as all the others. So that's a little hard to say. Four, acquisition of knowledge. Acquisition of knowledge. That means getting knowledge. How do we get it? Acquisition of knowledge. And then under that, I have a priori knowledge versus posteriori knowledge. So that's knowledge that you start with, or knowledge that you get after looking back at stuff. Go, oh, what did happen? Okay, what do I start out with? A priori is what you start out with. You guys are really lucky. I'm having to not give you a quiz because I'm running out of time. It's sitting, but you're going to get it on Tuesday. And it will still be on the midterm, but we'll put the answer key up online or just read you the right answer. Is there a second session?
I didn't want to today, but I
knew. There you go. There you go. We're on the top of our game. We get so interested in philosophy.
I hope you know
I am.
How are my
all that good stuff.